Please stay with us. Burbank Magazine, December 2002. We'll be right back.
Coming up on Burbank Magazine, through the magic of Burbank Verite, we'll relive the seesaw battle for Burbank from November 2002. And as we tour the world, we'll pay a visit of sorts to Asia, Europe, and Africa.
You're watching Burbank Magazine. Once again, Peter Masurlian.
Welcome back. On November 13th, the Burbank Bulldogs and the Burroughs Indians took to the gridiron for the 54th annual Varsity Football Crosstown Clash. In recapping the so-called battle for Burbank this year, Burbank Magazine sat down with the two quarterbacks from the two local high schools. Our signal caller for this 15-minute mini-documentary is Walter Lutz, who played both producer and editor in this unique look at the game in his latest installment of Burbank Verite.
That play is to Matt Welch, and it's a 28 stretch, and he does all the work himself, basically. He's not really a juking runner, but he shows his jukes here and jukes out a few people from Burbank High and finds his way into the end zone, does his little pointing at the end. Looks nice.
With a minute 14 to go in the first quarter, Matt Welch scored the first touchdown of the game. We weren't too concerned. Everyone gets their good plays, and we're ready to come back. Early in the second quarter, we're down 6-0, and we have Chips left Z12N with the backside post. We hit Brian Wang on the backside post for a touchdown.
Wang, we watched film on Wang. He didn't really do much on film, so we weren't really finding him a real threat, and they caught us off guard with a quick slant and scored a touchdown on it.
And Saul Krias made the extra point that put us up 7-6.
About a minute after Burbank took the lead, we drive back down the field, get about to the 30-yard line, and we run four, it looks like a veer right here, and I keep the ball, quarterback keep, and miss it. Some guy misses his tackle, and I score a touchdown, and do a little celebration at the end, a little unnecessary, but it's the Burbank Burroughs game.
With about 9 minutes to go in the second quarter, David Brooks makes an excellent run for a 29-yard touchdown. And we're thinking, we're down by 5 points, it's all right, we can make a comeback, still in the game.
Get out of the huddle, get out of the huddle. All right, we're gonna run sleeper here, boys. We're gonna go twins right, so Z and X are on the other side. All right, twins right, sleeper.
We're down by five, and Coach Sobiak calls sleeper, so the trick play where we pretend like we have a 12 guys on the field, one guy's coming off, and he stands on the sideline getting chewed up by the coach, and we snap the ball, and he's supposed to run up the field and throw him a long ball for a touchdown. But my cousin TJ got in the way of the play and messed us all up and didn't even score a touchdown in that birthday present I gave him.
That went back for Mike, you can't throw that thing.
Oh, no, but Johnny came across the middle.
Did you see where TJ was? He was right on top of me. He saw what we were doing. But what you got to do? What did I tell you to do? You got to throw the ball out of bounds.
44 seconds left in the half, and Dolphus makes a great run, scores a touchdown, give us a bigger lead.
We're thinking we're gonna go in the locker room, 18-7. Still got a chance, second half, and a couple other things happened.
Well, Mike McDonald's trying to make something happen here.
And I tried to hit John Dincher over the middle, and I threw it a little high, and it got picked off.
Makes a mistake, throws the Matt Patterson. He returns it for us, and it ends up costing him and the team. Well, in the huddle, Mark Meredith is saying, well, Wang's on my side, Wang's on my side, throw to his side, throw to his side. So I was like, all right, fine, I'll give Mark a chance. It's a Burbank game. So I just throw the ball up. I'm not known for having a great arm. And I just threw the ball up. He makes a great catch and gets us to the 3-yard line. This is our second touchdown in less than 30 seconds, and we're happy as heck right now going into halftime.
We're a little concerned going into halftime, but we know we got to bring it out in the second half, play our hardest.
-7 at halftime. It's a Burroughs route. We're feeling we're going to dominate this game. Coach was telling us this is our best offensive game we've had in a while. Keep it up, keep dominating.
We had a couple breaks go our way in the first half. We got to come out in the second half and really put the heat on them now. All right, we got to come out and we got to pound them and knock them out of any sense that they think that they have to come back in this game. Really, they only have one option, and that's to throw the ball. But there's two quarters left. Now, typically, they've played great second half football all year. It's not Burbank from the past. They gave up in the second half. This team has played good second half football. Okay, you guys, some of you guys that had to carry the ball on offense know that when they get to you, they can hit you pretty hard. They're not little, okay? But we need to basically finish them.
Stay focused, guys. These guys are talking about this thing is over already. I walked in with them. I walked in with their football team. They think that this thing is over already, that we have quit. Can you imagine? You guys haven't quit all year, but that's what they think. They think this game is over. Heck no is right. Listen to me. I want you to come back out with the same energy that you played the first half in. Our play will take care of itself. All right, you guys are going hard. You guys are going hard. We just got to come back out here and play Bulldog football just like we did the first half.
At halftime in the locker room, some of our players' heads are down, some of them are up, and Coach Sobia comes in, pick up your heads, guys, we're still in this game, and we were. And everyone changed their attitude and stepped it up and told each other, we're still in this game.
Well, we're 3 minutes into the second half, and everything that we said in the locker room has been coming true. We're first play of this drive, and we drive down the field 40 yards on one play. It's a quarterback keep, and
Brooks breaks a 45-yard run. We were thinking we were in it, and now everyone's heads have dropped down below their shoulders again.
A few plays after my 45-yard run, we give Matt Welch the ball. Matt Welch was the homecoming king, gets his second touchdown of the game.
With a couple minutes to go in the third quarter, we're driving the length of the field, passing and throwing, and Celica runs it in for a 6-yard touchdown and runs into the ref. Unfortunately, he's part of the field and he ended up being okay.
Celico did all this talking and looks like he got himself a touchdown.
We kick the extra point, it's 30-14, and we think momentum has swung to our side of the field.
This whole year, we've been having trouble stopping the quarterback sneak, and I'm sure Mike McDonald and the team noticed it.
And we took advantage of the quarterback sneak. We saw Canyon running that against Burroughs a lot.
Got himself a touchdown.
After the touchdown, we went for a 2-point conversion with Rico Clark on the fade, and we just took advantage of number 13's height, and we got the 2-point conversion.
This was the first game for Allen West playing center for us, and he had a problem with the snap, went over my head, and I got face masked and got up. I was very angry afterwards. Very upset with Celico.
Celico tried to make a play on the ball and face masked David Brooks, and luckily he came up and he was all right.
What could have been costly on the bobbled snap, they could have closed the gap on us, but instead we drive down the field again and score a 20-yard touchdown. The play is a counter to the right, and I end up cutting back to the left, scoring a touchdown.
The 15-yard penalty gave the Indians really good field position, and David Brooks ran a long touchdown run in to make the score 37-22 after their extra point, And we're thinking, you know, it's a Burbank Bros game, anything can happen, we're still in this, and keep our heads up.
We finally made an extra point with a great hold from Lee Pettit.
With 8 minutes to go, we're down by 15, we're driving the ball down the field, and we're gonna take a shot at the end zone. We call I right 909, two streaks. I threw it to Robert Nichols, and David Brooks, being the player that he is, makes a good play on the ball and turns the ball over for Bros.
Robert Nichols, the receiver to my side, I heard him talking to the quarterback saying he's playing soft on my side, and I knew he was going to throw to my side, so I kind of predicted the ball was going to be thrown over there, and I intercepted it.
Burroughs doesn't take advantage of the interception, and the ball is hiked over Brooks' head.
I had a feeling the ball was going to go over my head. That's like in the back of my head, I was afraid of that, and it did. I barely got it, and my good buddy Johnny Dencher comes in and gets me for the safety.
He got us 2 points, and we're getting the ball back.
With less than 4 minutes left to go, we're up by 13 in the game, and we knew they were going to go to the air to Rico Clark, and they did. And Rico Clark has an unbelievable catch to get them within seven.
We need a big play, so we call 22 Papa 909, which is all jet, and TJ made a good play on the ball, tipping it up, but Rico's concentration was just too good and got us the touchdown. And after the extra point, it made it 37-31, and it was anyone's ball game. Late in the fourth quarter, with only a couple minutes to go in the game, Burroughs, the center, snapped the ball over Brooks' head, and we sacked him for a loss, and old Mo is on our side.
The ball was snapped over my head, and it was very instinctive of me to go jump on the ball and basically run, get as many yards back again. But I ended up getting tackled, and I was kind of afraid of them coming back and winning the game.
Late in the game, with less than 2 minutes to go, Burroughs punts, and we get the ball on the 50-yard line. And we're thinking, we got to put the ball in the end zone. This is our game.
At this point, our whole defense is saying to themselves, we need to step up, we need to make a play. We knew they were going to go to the air, and they did.
With a little more than a minute left in the game, we called a pass play, and I had a lot of time to throw, but Burroughs' defense was pretty good. I had to scramble, and Rico Clark made a good play on the ball, coming back, and got it to bounce to stop the clock.
In the huddle after the play, I'm yelling at the defense, everybody's yelling at each other, we need to step up, we need to step up.
After a 5-yard penalty, we're on the 35-yard line, and we call Falcon right, 999, wide post. After the long post to John Dencher, got to the 9-yard line, and we're thinking we got 9 yards to go until our victory, and we get a penalty that called us all the way back.
This moment, I'm very scared. I'm totally thinking they're going to win the game, and we're going to have to make a miraculous comeback, but thank God there's a penalty on the play holding.
Instead of being on the 9-yard line, the penalty brought us all the way back to the 49-yard line. We had a pass play called, I made a bad read, threw it to the wrong receiver, and Dale Dietrich made a good play on the ball, put it into the end zone, and won the game.
I'm over to the left side of the field, and Daryl Dietrich is the linebacker to that side. And as soon as he threw the ball, I knew Daryl got under it. I didn't know if he was going to catch or not, but big man on campus, Daryl Dietrich catches the ball and scores a touchdown, beating Mike McDonald to the end zone, winning the game for us, basically.
Nick, pick your head up, man. Pick your head up, all right? Pick your head up. Keep your head up.
I was very happy with the way our team played, especially offensively. We actually drove the ball down the field, and we capped off a decade of winning versus Burbank, and hopefully more to come.
The next season has already started for me. I've been in the weights, I've been running, and so have my other teammates. We got a young team, we got a new head coach that's really good. We're going to carry this into spring ball and the summer ball and our new season, and hope to break that winning streak at Burroughs.
it's homecoming, but it's a crosstown rivalry, you know, 1.86 miles away, you know, 53 years, you know, and for us it was special tonight because it was 10 years in a row that we've beaten them.
I hate to say goodbye to this senior group. It's my first year here, and boy, they've taught me a lot. I don't know how I'll ever thank them. I mean, they're a wonderful group of young men. I'm certain that our high school is very proud of them.
It was obvious David Brooks was the player of the game for Burroughs. He played really good. He had 177 yards running as a quarterback. He threw the ball good, threw a couple touchdowns, and I give him the best wishes for college.
The rivalry now is going to get a lot more closer due to the new quarterback that Burbank has, Mike McDonald, rising star.
Coming up on Burbank Magazine, it's our extended world tour segment, during which we'll visit a few Japanese, some local Hungarians, and in country with the Botswana.
You're watching Burbank Magazine. Once again, Peter Masurlian.
Welcome back. The last part of this program is our extended world tour segment. To learn about that world, we can either take our cameras abroad or, in the case of Los Angeles County, just outside our front doors.
That couldn't have been more clear than in May 2002, when we videotaped this INS citizenship ceremony in Pomona. In all of 2002, more than 125,000 candidates for citizenship were naturalized in the INS Los Angeles District. On this particular day at the County Fairplex, 7,000 people from 100 countries were sworn in. The top five countries represented were Mexico, Vietnam, China, the Philippines, and Iran. We're guessing there weren't too many new Americans from the small Central European country of Hungary, but we did spot one in the crowd and asked her to do the following report on Hungary and three Burbank men who came to America half a century ago due to the same violent events in that country. Here's Burbank Magazine's guest reporter, Sylvia Gadani, with the story.
Alpine village in Torrance transforms itself one summer day a year from a German beer garden to the site of an unrivaled Hungarian festival. Through the perilous fall. 2002 was the 66th year for the festival, which is the largest gathering of Hungarian Americans in the Western United States. The festival is such a big deal, they even fly this guy in from Europe. Robert Kotai can be best described as the Billy Crystal of Hungary. Bordered by seven other countries, Hungary is a landlocked Central European country of 10 million people. In California, there were only 160,000 Hungarian Americans counted in the 1990 census. 10 years later, that number dropped to 133,000 in a state of 34 million people.
So more than ever, celebrating our heritage becomes critical. So be proud of who you are. We represent a great heritage. Éjjel a haza. Thank you.
Part of the celebration definitely revolves around food. From this popular Hungarian bread called langos, to perhaps the best known dish to Americans, Hungarian goulash soup.
And no traditional Hungarian lunch would be the same without some Hungarian sausage, some paprika flavored potatoes, and some sauerkraut, which is very similar to the sauerkraut eaten by Hungary's German and Austrian neighbors.
As is the case with any festival, there were vendors selling everything from China to jewelry. Even Burbank-based European Video was on hand, showcasing its library of Hungarian films. The highlight of the event was an appearance by a folk ensemble which performs traditional Hungarian folk dances, including one that's part two-step and part balancing act. While the annual festival is a time for food, music, and a day to renew old friendships, there's a painful memory that haunts many of the older Hungarians. In In October 1956, in the Hungarian capital of Budapest, what started out as a peaceful student protest against Russian occupation turned into a 12-day revolution. The short-lived jubilation was crushed when Soviet tanks rolled in. The legendary Hungarian freedom fighter was born, but thousands died, and more than 200,000 Hungarians fled the country. Many of them ended up in the United States. This monument in downtown Los Angeles is a memorial to the events of 1956. Each year in October, those dark days are recalled here in a ceremony with the focus on the Hungarian freedom fighter, who in January 1957 was Time magazine's Man of the Year.
Mert a múlt értelme a jövő.
The Hungarian flag's gaping hole is a symbol of the revolution. Freedom fighters in 1956 cut out the communist coat of arms that had been added to the flag 10 years earlier.
Let us remember our heroes, the victims of dictatorship and terror, the young people of Pest who disregarded dangers and fought against tyranny, the people of other cities and the provinces who participated hand in hand in the revolution and freedom fight.
The event always concludes with various Hungarian organizations placing flowers at the base of the monument. Burbank magazine paid a visit to three Burbank men who would not be in the United States today if not for the events of 1956. Otto Huber, László Tábori, and Stephen Veres. Many Burbankers know Otto Huber from his Hungarian deli at Clark and Brighton, right down the street from Burroughs High School, where he's been for 34 years.
Vanilla custard, please.
His infectious, jovial manner